That's right, everybody. Today we're going to be talking about the signal that Helldivers 2 is giving to PlayStation and why I think you're going to be seeing a lot of games go pretty much day and date to PC. And it's going to happen faster than you think. So why am I bringing this up now? Well, it turns out that at the time of this recording, Helldivers 2 has hit an all-time player peak of 155,000 players. And to make it even crazier, 122,000 people are playing right now concurrently. That is a 78% retention rate from its all-time peak just a few days ago. And to make things even more interesting, Helldivers also released on consoles and PC at the same exact time. Now, there were a couple of fanboys getting really upset about this, saying they don't want to do crossplay with PC gamers because we're cheaters, we're the worst, we pirate everything. But the thing is this is a major signal to Sony and PlayStation about why are we not just putting our games day and date onto PC, especially when Sony has been very upfront saying that yes, we are making quite a bit of a return from these PC ports, and on top of that, it merely only takes an email to get an approval for the port to go into production. To make things even crazier, PlayStation also bought Nixxis. Now, I've had my own concerns about Nixxis ports and things along that nature, but they are one of the better port studios that you have right now, and they have done quite a pretty good job with things like Miles Morales and the Spider-Man games, as well as Ratchet and Clank. I think they did Ratchet and Clank? Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Either way, correct me if I'm wrong. Nope. I'm right, I just checked. So you have all of these factors in place. You've got the right port studio, you got the ability to make them go ahead quickly, and you're seeing a live service game could become very successful at the exact same time and pretty much have the player base split evenly between both platforms. Any company would think to themselves, why are we sitting here and waiting a year plus to bring games to another platform where we're making less money when at this moment in time, Helldivers has reached the highest peak concurrent player count more than any other PlayStation port that we've ever put on the PC. It's beaten Spider-Man and it's beaten God of War. And when you can beat those two games specifically, that really does send a message directly that the biggest thing that PlayStation was missing in terms of what they're gonna be putting on the PC platform has always been marketing and knowledge of that game going there. Helldivers 2 being released the same day at the same time on both platforms, whether PC and console, pretty much goes to show that if Sony were to able to truly go ahead and say, hey, we're gonna market the game and say it's gonna be available on both places, we can really make a lot more money than just waiting a couple years and getting a couple hundred thousand copies, instead getting over a couple of million. And you can't use that same argument that we've heard all the time before. Well, what about the console? Is the console sales are gonna slow down? It's how they make their money. If console sales were slowing down because of PC ports, then you wouldn't have the PS5 selling 5-1 or 3-1 to the Xbox Series X, now would you? You wouldn't have the PS5 getting very close to PS2 levels of sales, now would you? And that really goes to show that so many markets are so vastly different. You can't simply just say that a PC gamer is going to go ahead and buy a console for an exclusive when really, that's not the case. They just want to go ahead and play their games on the PC. This is practically what's called a lost sale to so many other publishers and developers. We see it all the time with their excuse about adding DRM to PC games. Well, if we don't add the DRM and we get piracy, then we're just going to have a lost sale. Well, you were never going to have a sale in the first place because that customer was never going to buy your game in the first place. You see how that works? You see how those two things are connected? That's how that looks. But the difference is not about whether or not piracy is truly a lost sale. The real point is that's how publishers and companies see it. They see it as, we could have had this person buy our video game, but they're not gonna buy the box to go with it, so we lost them with that sale. So how do we make sure that we get a sale from that customer by also removing any barrier that we can between us and their money? And the way they do that is with PC ports. Ever since the initiative of the whole slate coming to PC, everything has been on the table. Regardless of what you would think personally as a fanboy, every game is on the table. Now, some are taking longer than others, like Ghost of Tsushima, Demon's Souls, Bloodborne would be the obvious choice. I don't know why that hasn't been done yet. It's a simple winning ticket. The timeline between games going on console to being on PC from PlayStation has been shortening every single release, and you're going to see it get closer, and now we're already having live service games go day and date to PC and the console. It's only a matter of time between we're seeing those great single player games, well, great depending upon which one you like, because a lot of them I don't like, go to PC and PlayStation console day and date. And honestly, I don't feel like it's going to impact the console sales whatsoever. Now, some people are going to bring back the argument about like, oh, Alex, development time and all of these other things. And how about the PC ports that are bad? Look, we've had things like the Iron Galaxy PC port of Uncharted 4 and how hard that was. Let's not use Iron Galaxy anymore, shall we? Companies don't want to limit the amount of products they can sell. They want to sell as much as they possibly can, and they're going to do that. And that's why I feel Helldivers is a true indicator and a marker as to PlayStation saying, whoa, we could really make a lot more money just putting these games day and date onto PC, or even shortening the window even further. Instead of a year or 2 years, why not 6 months or a quarter? And then having the proper marketing to back that up. Now, why do I think this? Well, basically my entire perspective on gaming. I am a PC gamer. I feel that having an open platform provides the most competition to you as a consumer, because now people are trying to fight for not only your dollar, but also your attention when there's other people competing in that space. By having that open platform, it allows you to make the decision that's best for you and where you want to spend your money. And you're not being restricted by other places about where you have to go to buy certain games or things along that nature. Let's take an example like this. Microsoft is placing their games onto Steam day one of their actual releases. This is the same company that made games for Windows Live, that horrible piece of garbage we had to deal with for so very long. So they could have easily gone ahead and say, hey, we're going to put our games on PC, but the only place you're going to be able to play them on PC is through our Windows Store or our Xbox app. And nobody wants to buy your game there. They want to use Steam, not because of the library, but because there's so many more features that Steam provides you that you don't really get anywhere else. And that brings me to my next point about Epic Games. I had a pretty big meltdown and rant about exclusivity on my live stream this Saturday, 8:45 p.m. Eastern. You should definitely check that out, where I pretty much explained why Epic Games is a bane on the PC gaming space. They are literally bringing in the same exact console-like mentality of locking games behind a store or any other kind of walled garden in order to force you into their platform to then use their storefront far more often to then avoid going anywhere else to actually play those games. They're not providing you a better experience. They're not competing with Steam. They're not doing anything that provides you, the consumer, with a better overall reason as to why to go to that storefront. They're merely locking the content away from other places where you want to go to then go ahead and use their storefront instead. And that is the biggest issue of all of this. I can make a direct correlation and point as to what Epic Games is doing to PC gaming as to what consoles do to each other on a consistent basis. And nobody likes Epic Games because of it. People simply go there, they get their free game, they close Epic Games down, and then they go back to Steam. It's the same thing happening all the time. And if you're saying no, well, you're a liar or you're just one of those Fortnite kiddos. And don't get me started about this whole thing of like, oh, it's free, you don't have to pay for it, just use an email. It's not about that. You see, if I took a dump on a plate and I handed it to you at 12:30 and saying, hey, here's your free lunch, it's a piece of shit on the plate, you're not gonna just take that piece of shit and eat it, are you? Even though it's free? Look, what you do in your personal time is your business, but at least try to have standards in your life, you know what I mean? So yes, having that kind of mentality doesn't work well at all. And the same thing happens in console space. But the thing is though, I think Helldivers really proves the fact that PlayStation is going to be starting to look at the kind of sales they get when they release games day and date, whether it's live service or not, and they're going to be saying, why don't we do this with everything instead? Because at the end of the day, they are not only a hardware manufacturer, but they're also a company trying to make money. And companies love money. Especially if those same customers are not going to buy your hardware in the first place. But I think the funniest thing about all of this isn't just the fact that this is truly happening. I think the real funny thing is fanboys on the PlayStation side are still trying to use Steam metric numbers and Steam sales as some sort of like gotcha or win against other fanboyish communities. Like, how are you going to celebrate the fact that you are losing your exclusives, which you purposely say are the reason to buy the console, and say, haha, look at this game having a high amount of Steam users, a high amount of Steam sales, therefore, we're better than Xbox. I don't. And if you think I'm kidding, and if you think I'm like truly like just making shit up, take a look at this. I mean, this Chris Hart guy is consistently sucking off the cock of Sony on a consistent basis, talking about Helldivers 2 is still the top selling game on Steam, but Pow World is trying to fight back. Pow World, he thinks Pow World is trying to fight back. The only reason he cares about Pow World and fighting back is because Pow World is on Xbox. That's the only reason he cares about this. And the fact that Pow World is number 2 right now and not like number 30 or 40 on sales truly means that game is an actual juggernaut. It's got over 1 million concurrent players right now at the time of this recording, while Helldivers has a tenth of that. So what are you talking about, my bro? Even the CEO of Arrowhead had to make sure to correct you, saying that even right now between both platforms, there are about 1 million units sold, but they still have a gap that's very large between Helldivers and Palworld, literally debunking your entire thing. Or this fucking clown that we see on a daily basis, J-Dub, how it started versus how it's going. Helldivers 2 is greater than Palworld, where he talks about Palworld losing 2/3 of its players in 2 weeks. Yes, J-Dub, do you know what 2/3 of 8 million people are? It's still over 1 million people playing the fucking game! Like, how do you sit here and think this is a W, again, using this shit for the same console war nonsense? And then again, both of these clowns talking about Steam numbers and Steam stats, trying to go ahead and use it for actual console wars. Even if the boxes go away, even if every game is multi-platform, all they will talk about then is how many users and engagement they have on their service compared to the other one, and then how much better their games are on Metacritic. So truly, we're gonna keep seeing this over and over again, because even when you lose your actual exclusives that you used to say, sell the console, you're now using Steam charts and Steam numbers to prove your actual point while you are losing your own argument. It's truly pathetic. And that really goes to show what's actually happening here. These fanboys are pretty much admitting to themselves, hey, at some point, these exclusive games that I've been bragging about for the last 5+, 10+ years are going to go to multiple platforms. And PlayStation, I'm going to call it right now, will in fact become a third-party publisher. Hell, they already are a third-party publisher. MLB The Show is already on every platform. And I know you'd be like, well, MLB has a contract, and you know, it's not gonna... They had to work with MLB to do that. Guess what? They're a third-party publisher. They have their own PlayStation Studios page on Steam with those exclusives you guys have been bragging about the entire time. They are now putting their games on a separate platform. They are now, in fact, a third-party publisher because Steam is a third party. Ta-da! You played yourself. That's how it goes. Even if Xbox puts their games on the PlayStation, which honestly they already have been doing with Minecraft, and now you can clearly say that Call of Duty is in fact on PlayStation because that's not going anywhere either, Xbox is already a third-party publisher. We are living in this space right now where exclusives truly are the worst thing to happen to a consumer because they are literally forcing you to spend more money to get into an ecosystem that you then have to pay for online to then go ahead and pay another bill that you have to do to play your actual game online to finally play a video game that they've money-hatted into their own platform because they don't want anybody else to do it. So now you have to wait either for it to come on the PC or then have it to go some really weird way because they want you to be in their ecosystem to spend more money. That's too much work for them. They're just gonna say, put this shit on PC day one because they are buying these fucking games. Ta-da! And at some point, once that levy breaks, the other one will break too because the console is going to go away and your phone or your TV is going to be where you're going to play and stream your games moving forward. Congratulations, you're gonna eat the bugs, you're gonna live in a pod, and you're gonna own nothing, and especially a home. And to tie all of that back together, every excuse you can think of truly does not work when you try to look at this and say, how much money is the company going to make if they just put their games day and date on PC? And it goes to show that the second that that line intersects with the, yes, we're making more money line, they're gonna do it because these companies are not your friend. They're here for your wallet. They're here to prolapse your wallet and pull out every red cent they possibly can. So instead of actually thinking about things with your own ideological stupid self and how you've invested your entire being into a plastic box, think of it as how it's gonna be beneficial for you in the long run and how many more games you get to play, because now you don't have to spend even more money on a box you never liked in the first place. So with all of that being said, I want to know what you guys think in the comment section down below. Do you think that Helldivers 2 is going to truly trigger the entire point of PlayStation moving even closer to day and date for their games? Or do you think this may in fact just be a simple one-off and really we're just looking into the tea leaves too closely? Now, if you want to see more of this kind of content, more PC port reviews, gaming news, Steam Deck videos, as well as live streams every 8:45 p.m. Eastern on a Saturday, consider becoming a subscriber. We're getting close to 62,000 subs and it really does mean a lot. Now, if you want to have access to emotes and Discord access, just become a YouTube member. It's as low as a dollar. And if you don't want to spend the buck, don't sweat it. Just come on down on Saturdays, hang out to the live chat. Everybody makes fun of me for being bald, a furry, using TTS to berate me, and then spamming feet in the chat for 5 hours. This is the community that I've made. Unbelievable. But with that being said, I want to say thank you guys so much for watching. Hope you have a great one, and I'll see you next time.